Hello everyone, my name is Joshua Pulsipher and I'll be talking to you today about how we can tackle infinite dimensional optimization problems with InfiniteOpt. To overview today, we'll be talking about how we can take traditional formulations such as dynamic, PDE, and stochastic optimization, how all of these can be brought together via the abstraction behind InfiniteOpt, and how this can facilitate new formulations that help us capture emerging applications. This outlines how we'll go about tackling that today, and with that, let's jump into it. So what is finite optimization? Well, it's an optimization problem in which we have to make scalar decisions. And these problems can entail parameters, so quantities or data that we can't change, like these fixed numbers in this formulation here. Then we have decision variables, which are the scalar entities we need to choose. So we're going to have a finite number of these. Even though the number of decisions we could end up choosing might be infinitely many, there's only finitely many decisions we're making. The objective function, that's going to characterize the best solution. And constraints that will entail the restrictions and modeling concerns of the problem. And these problems can generally be depicted graphically in terms of the dimensions of the decisions. These types of models can be readily tackled using JuMP by establishing a model, defining the variables we need, adding the objective, and defining the constraints, and then solving it with our solver of choice. And all of this in a convenient syntax, which is why, of course, we like using JuMP. So then, what is infinite optimization? Well, the difference here is that instead of scalar decisions, we're choosing decision functions. So the new aspects that come into play are what we call infinite variables, or these decision functions, which essentially equate to, you can think of them as manifolds that we're trying to shape as best dictated for a particular problem. And here, because we usually have a continuum, there are infinitely many decisions over the space of that function that we need to make. Moreover, this is compounded in complexity by the addition of measures, such as integrals or risk measures, and of course, derivative objects that often come up in these types of models as well. With this in mind, let's talk about the unifying abstraction we've developed to capture these types of problems. We begin with infinite domains and parameters. And with infinite domains, they're domains of infinite cardinality, in other words, continuous spaces, and examples might include, for example, a time interval or a codomain of a multivariate distribution. We can then define infinite parameters which live on these domains and derive the problem domain by taking the Cartesian product of these individual domains. And this assumes, of course, that they'd be independent of one another, which is an assumption we can relax, but one we'll use today for simplicity in presentation. Next, we have decision variables, which first include infinite variables, which are those decision functions, which depend on infinite parameters as inputs, and these are the manifolds we're trying to shape. We can then have semi-infinite variables, which correspond to a restricted portion of that function. We can see the red line on the manifold to see how those two correspond. And we can have point variables, which are the infinite variables defined at a particular point of interest. Again, we can see how those two figures correspond to one another. And we can also have regular finite variables, which are independent of infinite domains and denote this other decisions we might want to make, such as first stage variables from stochastic optimization. We also have what we call operators, beginning first with derivative operators denoted D. These capture how a particular infinite variable might change over its infinite domain. We could think of, for example, partial derivatives or Laplace operators, for example. We also have what we call measure operators, which seek to sort of summarize or collapse functions or infinite variables over an infinite domain of interest. So we can see here how we have a measure M, evaluating over the domain T, and how this then gives us a semi-infinite variable that's collapsed over that domain T. All these types of things start to come into play as we think about objectives that might happen. And the challenge we have here is we can't directly embed infinite variables or functions directly into these because they'd be ill-posed. And to deal with this, we try to scalarize them by means of using measure operators, as we can see through our notation here, applying a measure operator m to the function f. Examples of this that commonly come up might be, for example, enforcing space-time integrals over a particular cost function, or perhaps enforcing the expectation over a stochastic cost function as well, as illustrated here on the right. Finally, to capture these types of infinite dimensional problems, we have, of course, constraints, which we'll divide into two categories. The first we'll loosely call algebraic constraints, which enforce a certain infinite dimensional function g over all the values of its infinite parameters d. And this can be illustrated, as we see here on the right, with this constraint system, which might be manifest, for example, with a space-time system where we're enforcing DAE constraints. Then we can have measure constraints, where we have a measure that operates on a constraint function h, and we enforce that to a certain threshold. These are manifest, for example, when we consider chance constraints in stochastic optimization. Now that we can characterize an infinite dimensional model, we have to go about solving it. To this, we consider transformations, in which we want to take an infinite model and convert it into a finite formulation that's amendable to traditional optimization solvers. This is most commonly done via direct transcription, in which we develop a set of discretization points in which to project our problem such that we can express it in terms of point variables, which are finite and can be handled by traditional solvers. However, because we've generalized our characterization independent of this, we could foresee using other techniques such as the method of weighted residuals, in which instead we project our decision functions in terms of known functions called basis functions, and can then express an optimization problem in terms of the finite coefficient variables that correspond to each one. And this now highlights how we could start to think of non-traditional transformations to go about solving these types of problems. Now let's talk about how we implement this abstraction in InfiniteOpt. Where InfiniteOpt is a JuMP extension for tackling infinite dimensional optimization problems. So what makes it different from some of the other packages that exist out there? Well, it implements the unifying abstraction we've just finished talking about. It directly incorporates random spaces as provided by distributions.jl. It also decouples the infinite model from the transformation methods we want to use to solve it, as we just talked about. And of course, it's in Julia. It implements a range and wealth of capabilities as summarized here, as we will go over in the coming slides. First, let's talk about the syntax for infinite parameters, which can incorporate a variety of infinite domains and supports if we wish to use transcription later on. We could, for example, define a time parameter, a parameter over an infinite horizon, a spatial parameter x, or a random parameter xc that follows a multivariate Gaussian distribution. Again, all this following a very symbolic and intuitive syntax. We can also incorporate any of the variables we've discussed so far and define these using the JuMP variable macro. So for example, we can define this infinite variable y, or this restricted integer variable yb. We can also define semi-infinite variables using the macro syntax, or more conveniently using this functional syntax. And we can do the same thing with point variables, again using that more convenient functional syntax. And we can, of course, define regular finite variables by simply employing the JuMP variable macro as normal. For derivative operators, we support derivatives of arbitrary orders that can act on arbitrary infinite variables or expressions. For example, we could have the second partial derivative of this infinite variable here. We could have this more complex partial derivative actor, or something more exciting, like taking the derivative with respect to our measured function. We could also think of measure operators, where we support measures of arbitrary structures and natively support things like integrals and expectations. They can even be multivariate in nature. So we could use our integral function, for example, as shown here, or the expectation. And we can support arbitrary functions using our extendable measure API. For example, maybe defining risk measures. Bringing these modeling elements together, we can now go about defining a model by initializing an infinite model, adding in our infinite parameters with their associated information, add in our decision variables with their associated properties, defining the objective function, even one that involves complex measures in this way very compactly, define our constraints, which is these DAE chance and point constraints, again, very compactly with our syntax, and solve it by simply pushing optimize and letting InfiniteOpt take care of the rest. Let's talk about how that infinite model was solved behind the scenes following our transformation API, in which the infinite model was defined, transformed with a particular transformation into a finite JuMP model, which can then interact seamlessly with the infinite model. By default, we implement direct transcription, which features a sophisticated support management system and a wide variety of derivative and measure approximations that we can choose to employ. Moreover, I want to highlight how performant this system is, and when we compare automatic transcription in InfiniteOpt to manual transcription in JuMP, not necessarily a fair comparison, we see that InfiniteOpt scales quite competitively in comparison. Moreover, I want to highlight that this API is fully extensible and will allow diverse methods, such as the method weighted residuals that we talked about before, to be implemented. And we provide diverse, or rather detailed templates, tutorials, and documentation to enable just that. The other thing I want to highlight is that, coming back to this idea that we want to unify these different fields into one space such that we can innovate, that InfiniteOpt helps in doing this as well, is that it's fully extendable in all the aspects that I've just gone through describing, and we provide extensive resources to help researchers do just that and implement their methods such that they can be leveraged to innovate in emerging applications. With this in mind, I'll present two brief case studies to highlight this principle of how we can take traditional fields as dynamic and stochastic optimization, and through the lens of our abstraction, derive new and innovative ways of solving problems. For our first case study, we consider generalizing the conditional value at risk measure that comes from stochastic optimization and try to apply it to other problem classes. In this, the CVAR measure is given by the expectation of extreme or high cost events with a certain probability 1 minus alpha. This is illustrated here on the right when graphed in terms of the probability of a certain function. That it's the region there in pink, that it is the higher cost region that we're evaluating the expectation. Where special cases, if we move it all the way to the right, would become the maximum, or if we move it all the way over to the left, we would simply be taking the expectation of the whole function as normal. We can generalize this if we view this in terms of what we call an excursion, where essentially we're trying to compute the average of a function over past a certain threshold. And then this notion can be generalized to other domains, as we're seeing in the following example. And for more information, you can review our paper for the thorough analysis. We demonstrate this by showing how CVAR can shape time trajectories in an optimal control problem, where what we want to do is control the spread of a contagion, as described by the CVAR model, in which we're going to have a statically uncertain parameter, so it's independent of time. And this formulation will be given by minimizing the CVAR of the isolation policy we're enforcing in our population over time, enforcing the CVAR model, ensuring that the number of infected individuals stays below a certain threshold, and finalizing other considerations in our problem. This is readily modeled in InfiniteOpt following our intuitive syntax as shown here, and we can obtain the answer. Well, what we see is, as we vary the value of alpha closer to 1, therefore capturing more and more extreme events, we can see that the policy becomes more and more smoothed out. And we can see the adjustability that the CVAR gives us in shaping the time trajectories of our problem. For our last study, we consider lifting discrete time estimation problems to continuous time, where these traditional formulations consider taking, for example, the sum of squared error between the data and the fitted prediction based off a discrete model with parameter z that we're trying to fit. We can make this into a continuous formulation by introducing lifting functions fk that fit the discrete data experiment such that we can use a continuous time model and objective. And there's a few reasons why we might want to do this. One is that as a pre-processing step, these lifting functions help smooth out noisy data. And two, these continuous functions will enable us to use more accurate derivative and integral approximations by introducing more points. We apply this to a biological model identification problem, where we want to fit the Lobkowicz-Volterra model to experiments we have from a 12-species microbial community, in which the model is given by a series of first-order differential equations. We want to fit the parameters or variable z. And here we can see what this model would look like in our continuous formulation. Note that we're going to be using sinusoidal lifting functions, as those seem to work well for this particular case. We can implement this quite compactly and into InfiniteOpt. And when we get our results, we find that most of the experimental data is fit quite well. And if we blow this up a little closer and compare it to the discrete time case, we highlight that as we take the continuous formulation, that we improve the accuracy by several orders of magnitude, which can be attributed to reducing the noise and having more accurate approximations. Now, because this is JuMP Dev, I thought I'd take a few moments as well to talk about my experience in extending JuMP. So let's first talk about what went well in extending JuMP. First off, I thought that fine quadratic expressions were quite easy to extend and very convenient with the API provided by JuMP. Moreover, constraint creation, as we've seen as InfiniteOpt carries out, was quite easy to do in extending the constraint macro. I've also really appreciated the community of support I've received along the way, especially from Oscar. That's helped me out with quite a few different questions. And also, I want to highlight that I found, in general, the code readability in JuMP to be very good, and that was very beneficial as well. Finally, I'll talk about some past and ongoing challenges I've had. First being of documentation, that when I started, there was little to no documentation on how to extend JuMP, but Oscar's recently made some good progress on that. Though there's still room to add docs about how to extend and make new JuMP models, which is what InfiniteOpt does. Perhaps even providing a template of how to do so would be very helpful. Another issue that comes up quite often of our user base is that for extensions, the nonlinear interface from JuMP is unusable, non-extendable. And we're very much looking forward to that being resolved by the next version of the nonlinear. Also, a public container API would be very helpful in defining extension macros, like what we do with the infinite parameter. And that's detailed more on the relevant issue shown there. As we conclude, let's see where InfiniteOpt has been, where we had initial work begin in 2019, releasing the first version in early 2020. Then adding some significant improvements to version 2 to make it much more performant, adding derivatives to version 3, adding a whole bunch of features that are now in the current version 4, and with lots of plans for development in the future. And we would encourage anyone interested in any of this to reach out on GitHub. So to conclude, I would encourage everyone that's made it here to the end to please check out InfiniteOpt and check out our paper for even more information. Let us know if you have any questions or comments. And I'd also like to acknowledge my support from the University of Wisconsin and the Department of Energy. Thank you.